All of us are here today to discuss a very interesting facet of math. It's game theory. So, game theory, before I go on to what game theory actually is, game theory has super broad applications. So, you take computer science, you take economics, econometrics, all of the modern developing fields, statistical analysis, everything, it is based on game theory. So, this is one of those areas of math that is not really dry. So sometimes people feel like algebra finding X or Y, that's kind of monotonous and boring. However, this really racks your brain and it helps you develop that instinct for math, right? So even though there's not a huge hell lot of math involved, but it's still very intricate and it needs logic and thinking, right? So as Nikhil said, you can put your questions in the questions tab. I think we'll start right now. Cool. Just a second. Right. So here we are. You've seen, I mean, all of us have heard the saying, life's a game. So life really is a game. Like if you go mathematically, life is a game. So let's see how. Let's take an example. We'll walk through. But before that, I wanted to show you a couple of videos, which give you an essence of what game theory is, right? So if I had to sum game theory up in one line, I would say that game theory is thinking what your opponent will do. You're playing a game. It need not necessarily be a board game like maybe chess or snakes and ladders. It can be any game. It can be a real life situation too. It can be modeled to be a game, right? So in that case, you will have an opponent and you think what your opponent will do, then based on that, you make your choice, right? So Devin, if you would, could you start the video?
So, it is down to you, and it is down to me. If you wish you're dead, by all means, keep moving forward.
Let me explain.
There's nothing to explain. You're trying to kidnap what I've rightfully stolen.
Perhaps an arrangement can be reached?
There will be no arrangement, and you're killing her.
Well, if there can be no arrangement, then we are at an impasse.
I'm afraid so. I can't compete with you physically, and you're no match for my brains.
You're that smart.
Let me put it this way. Have you ever heard of Plato, Aristotle, Socrates?
Yes.
Morons.
Really? In that case, I challenge you to a battle of wits.
For the princess? To the death? I accept.
Good. Then pour the wine. Inhale this, but do not touch.
I smell nothing.
What you do not smell is called iocane powder. It is odorless, tasteless, dissolves instantly in liquid, and is among the more deadly poisons known to man. Where is the poison? The battle of wits has begun. It ends when you decide and we both drink and find out who is right and who is dead.
But it's so simple. All I have to do is divine from what I know of you. Are you the sort of man who would put the poison into his own goblet or his enemy's? Now, a clever man would put the poison into his own goblet because he would know that only a great fool would reach for what he was given. I'm not a great fool, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you. But you must have known I was not a great fool. You would have counted on it, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of me.
You've made your decision then?
Not remotely. Because iocane comes from Australia, as everyone knows. And Australia is entirely peopled with criminals. And criminals are used to having people not trust them, as you are not trusted by me, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you.
Truly, you have a dizzying intellect.
Wait till I get going! Where was I?
Australia.
Yes, Australia. And you must have suspected I would have known the powder's origin, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of me.
You're just stalling now.
You'd like to think that, wouldn't you? You've beaten my giant, which means you're exceptionally strong. So you could have put the poison in your own goblet, trusting on your strength to save you, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you. But you've also bested my Spaniard, which means you must have studied. And in studying, you must have learned that man is mortal, so you would have put the poison as far from yourself as possible, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of me.
You're trying to trick me into giving away something. It won't work.
It has worked! You've given everything away! I know where the poison is!
Then make your choice.
I will! And I choose... What in the world can that be?
What? Where? I don't see anything.
Oh, well, I could have sworn I saw something. No matter.
What's so funny?
I'll tell you in a minute. First, let's drink. Me from my glass, and you from yours.
You guessed wrong.
You only think I guessed wrong. That's what's so funny. I switched glasses when your back was turned. Ha ha, you fool. You fell victim to one of the classic blunders. The most famous is never get involved in a land war in Asia. But only slightly less well known is this. Never go in against a Sicilian when death is on the line.
Who are you?
I'm no one to be trifled with. That is all you ever need know.
To think, all that time it was Shortcut that was poisoned.
They were both poisoned. I spent the last few years building up an immunity to Iocane powder.
So there's a guy who comes to save the princess, and he challenges the smart guy to a battle of wits, and he pours the poison into both the glasses, but the guy who has kidnapped the princess, he thinks he's very smart. So he reasons with him, saying, I cannot choose the wine in front of you. But then he says, I cannot choose it in the wine in front of me. Then he says, I cannot choose the one in front of you. And this goes on. So in the end, he tries to trick the guy who comes to save the princess. But in the end, he fails because the savior who had come to save the princess, he had put poison in both the cups. And so he died. The reason that the guy did not die because he had built up an immunity to poison. So the part of game theory here was how the Sicilian guy tried to reason that I cannot choose it in front of you, I cannot choose the one in front of me. So that is how he logically deduced which one to choose, and then he tried to trick the other. This was a game, as you can call it, where one had to win to stay alive and keep the princess. So on similar lines, there is another video. It's from a TV serial, Penguins of Madagascar. I'm sure all of you have heard of it. So I'll give you a context behind it. So the penguins had gone to a mission to get some fish. However, penguins' neighbors, lemurs, they did not want penguins to eat fish because they were fish are smelly. So a game started between them where the penguins' mission was to get the fish, and the lemur's mission was to stop penguins from getting the fish. So here's the video. Look at it and enjoy how smartly they argue with one another, how they trick one another into giving away something, and how in the end, one of them wins. Watch.
One small problem. We could not allow for you to return to eating the savage, smelling, foul, fuming, fishy fish. So I plan to come up with my own carefully planned plan. To plan to steal the stinkies ourselves. And my plan all went accordingly to plan. So you see, we have the crates with the real fish, while yours are filled with only the phony fish cakes. So, ha-ha-ha-ing.
Oh, nice try, Ringtail. But I know how much you hate the smell of fish. I was expecting a move like that. Which is why I switched the crates before you even got back to the zoo.
Ah, But I was expecting you to be expecting that. So we switcheroo the crates on the pier before the fish got loading onto the truck.
Ha! Doesn't really matter, because I just switched these crates during your last flashback.
Well, I switched them while you were saying that you switched them.
And I switched them the last time you blinked.
Yes, but I pretended to switch them so you actually switched them back.
Oh, but I double switched.
And I triple switched.
I million zillion switched.
I switched them to infinity. So you have to shut up a little bit.
Ah, but what you didn't see coming
is that I am actually you. Okay, nicely played. But if you are me, then by processing of elimination,
I must be you.
Maybe, maybe. But if you are me and I am you, then we must both be.
Enough! Can we just crack these babies open and get this over with already, please?
Right, so that was a very nice clip, isn't it? So the lemur and the penguin both keep telling each other how they anticipated the other's move, and they did something that would affect, that would help them win the game. And in the end, there's a really weird twist to it. One of them is the other. So that's just something kind of fantasy. But you see the essence of game theory, right? How you anticipate what your opponent is going to do. Based on that, you make your move so that you win. And based on your thinking, your opponent also thinks something and then he does something, right? So there is this chain that goes on of thinking. So here I'm going to start with my presentation. So let's get back there. Here we are. So life's a game, right? We've seen two examples, and this has pretty much proved that life's a game. But let's delve deeper, right? So let's say you and your friend are going out in the open. So this one on the left who's wearing the hat, let's consider that this person is you. And the one who's on the right who's wearing the goggles is your friend. Let's assume this, all right? So you were walking out in the open, and your friend suddenly had the urge to place a bet. So he thinks that he should bet something, and it's just a friendly bet, right? So he wants some fun. So he sees a couple of pigeons on the bottom right of the screen. You can see a couple of pigeons who are sitting in front of a grain of food, right? So he says that, he tells you, hey, look at those two pigeons who are sitting in front of that grain. What do you think will happen? So he said, place a bet on one of these following two scenarios, right? So what are the two scenarios? Scenario one is that one of the pigeon gets the grain and eats it. Scenario two is that none of them gets the grain, right? So if one of the pigeons gets the grain, you can either bet for that scenario, or you can bet for the case where neither of the pigeons get the grain. So since it's pretty obvious that since there is a grain and there are two pigeons, one of them will obviously get the grain, right? So you naively bet for scenario one. But your friend, who is really, really smart, gives you a very sly grin, and you are confused, like, why is he smiling? I mean, if there's a grain, then one of the pigeons will obviously get the grain, right? However, that might not actually be the case. So let's analyze the situation, right? So let's stop time over here, and we will make three assumptions about the situation. Each pigeon is smart enough to know that if he bangs his head with the other one, he will pass out. So consider that the grain is in front of the two pigeons and both of them strike for the grain. Then of course, they will bang their heads and they will fall unconscious, right? So none of the pigeon wants that, and the pigeons know that if they both strike and fall unconscious, then that won't be good for them, right? So this is a fair assumption to make, right? The second assumption is called the perfect rationality assumption. It's a term in economics, but what it essentially means is each pigeon will make a rational choice. So if something is bad for the pigeon won't do it. And if something is good, then the pigeon will consider doing it, right? So even this is a fair assumption. Like, even in everyday life, if something is not good for us, we don't do it. If something is good for us, then we do it. So this is a fair assumption. The third assumption is that each pigeon is equally hungry, so that there's no bias between the two pigeons, and you know, the pigeons are equal, right? So pardon. So based on these three assumptions, we are going to analyze the situation and grab hold of your seats. This is going to get kind of mind-boggling. Okay, so let's name the pigeons Porky and Dave, just so that we can differentiate between the two. And it's a grain battle going on between them. So they have a grain in front of them and they're trying to get the grain, right? So let's see what cases we have. So in case one, we say that Porky strikes for the grain while Dave waits. So each pigeon can do either of the two. Either the pigeon can wait or the pigeon can strike. So in case one, if Porky is striking for the grain and Dave is not, then of course Porky will get the grain, right? So I put a crown on Porky's head just to show that Porky is the winner in this case, and an exclamation mark in front of Dave just to show that he's the loser in this case, right? So case one is where Porky strikes, Dave waits, and Porky gets the grain. Case two, the other way around. Dave strikes, Porky waits, and Dave gets the grain. So these two cases are fairly straightforward, right? One of them strikes, one of them waits, and the one who's striking gets the grain. Simple enough. Let's move on to case three, where both of them strike. If both of them strike with the grain, then they will bang their heads and they will fall unconscious, right? So in this case, nobody will get the grain. They are both losers in this case. So let me repeat over here. If both of them strike for the grain, then they will bang their heads together and they will fall unconscious. So this scenario is not good for either of the pigeons, right? So they will, so if they fall unconscious, then neither of them will get the grain. And case four is where neither of them strikes and both of them just sitting watching each other. So even in this case, neither of them gets the grain, right? So here's a summary of the four cases. I'll quickly repeat. Case one, where Porky strikes, Dave waits, Porky gets the grain, Porky wins. Case two, Dave strikes and Porky waits, Dave gets the grain, Dave wins. Simple enough. Case three, both of them strike and bang their head, both of them fall unconscious, and neither of them gets the grain. Case four, where both of them do not strike, both of them are waiting, and neither of them gets the grain. So I want you to appreciate the fact that these are the only four cases possible. There is no fifth case that can be possible over here, right? So right now, what I want you to do, everybody who's watching, I want you to vote for one of the two scenarios that were originally shown. Here they are. So if you think that one of the pigeon will get the grain, I want you to vote for scenario one. I'll create a poll right now. So if you think that one of the pigeon will get the grain, then say yes. And if you think none of them will get the grain, say no, right? So let me create a poll. Go on, vote. I'm waiting for your votes. Yes or no? And think through it, right? So don't just go with yes or no based on intuition, right? So think over it, not based on what I said, what you think. If there is a grain and you see two pigeons, what commonly happens? Does one of the pigeons get the grain or does one of the pigeons not get the grain? Right, so I think we have all of our votes, and people are still voting. Let's wait. This is interesting. This is not what I expected to be, but let's see. Okay, so I think we're done with the votes. I'll share the results at the end. Right, so that's that. Let's get back to Dave and Porky's grain battle. So before that, is everything clear over here? Are there any doubts or something that you may have, something that you're unable to understand? If so, feel free to raise your hand. Okay, so I don't see any doubts. Anyways, we'll be stopping in the middle for breaks and for questions anyways, so you can ask them too, right? So I hope everything is clear right now. I'll give a quick summary of what we've done. Just let me share my screen for a second. Right, so what we've done is, there are two pigeons poised over a grain of food. One of them is Porky, one of them is Dave, and we've seen four cases in what can be, these are the only four cases, there can be no fifth case, right? So now, what will happen, right? So that's the big question. Will one of them get the grain or will neither of them get the grain? Well, intuitively, it does seem like one of them does get the grain, right? Since if the grain is there and there are two pigeons, it's common sense that one of them should get the grain, right? Why would a pigeon not get a grain if it's in front of him? So you have voted for what you have. And here's the math behind it. Okay, so the only math we need is plus one, zero, and minus one, right? So let me explain it here. If a pigeon gets the grain, then we can give a plus one to that pigeon, just like we give marks in exams, right? So if it's a correct answer, that means if you win or if you get the grain, then it's a simple plus one. If you don't get the grain, then it's a zero, right? It's fair enough. If you get the grain, plus one. Don't get the grain, zero. And if you bang your head and fall unconscious, then that's not something that you would like, right? So that's a minus one. So these three things are the only math we need, right? So based on this simple plus one, zero, minus one math, game theory extends to so many fields, right? So we'll see how that happens. So here were the four cases. So in case, let's assign numbers to the pigeons, right? So in case one, where Porky is striking, Dave is waiting, and Porky is wearing the crown. So Porky gets one and Dave gets zero, right? So this is what we assigned over here. If you get the grain, then it's one. And if you don't get the grain, it's zero. And in case you fall unconscious, then it's a minus one. So in case one, Porky gets one and Dave gets zero. And you can imagine what happens in case two. Any guesses? Right. So Porky will get zero and Dave will get one. Straightforward. In case three, we see that both of them are falling unconscious. So both of them get a minus one, right? So this is a negative marking for both of them. And in case four, where both of them are just waiting and looking at the other pigeon, it's a null-null situation. So both of them get zero, right? So this marking is essential to understand what's happening here. Let me go over this once again, just so that if you have any doubts in your mind, they'll be clear. Case one, where Porky is getting the grain, he's getting one. Case two, where Dave is getting the grain, he's getting one. Case three, where both of them are banging their heads and falling unconscious, it's minus one to both of them. And in case four, where neither of them is doing anything, it's a 0-0, right? So this marking is completely fair. I can assure you that. It's been mathematically checked. I mean, I know it doesn't seem like something that should be checked mathematically. But yes, so this marking is fair. And the analysis we'll do after this will be very interesting, right? So hold on. So these are the four cases. Now I want you to analyze the column written Dave, right? So in case one, Dave gets 0. Case two, Dave gets one. So case two is the best case for Dave, right? So in cases one, three, and four, Dave is getting less than one. It's either a zero or a minus one. So, right. So the second case is Dave's best case scenario. Now, what we will do is, here's where the actual game theory starts, right? We will assume, we will think what Porky may be thinking, right? So let's assume we are Porky. Let's get into Porky's head for a second. And let's try to see what Porky might be thinking. And based on that thinking, Porky will decide whether he should strike for the grain or not. Right? So keeping in mind that Dave's best case scenario is two, let's start thinking like Porky. Since Dave's best case scenario is two, where Dave strikes, Porky will assume that Dave will strike. This is fair, right? If Dave's best case scenario is where he strikes, then it is safe to assume that Dave will strike, right? So Porky assumes that Dave will strike. Simple enough. Now, Porky is faced with a choice. Should I strike or should I not strike? Okay, so this flowchart that is going to be presented on the screen, this is the heart of what I'm going to explain today, right? So pay really good attention to it. And don't worry if you don't get a part. I'll be going over it, the whole thing, twice, right? And if you have any questions after that, I'll be taking them too, right? So focus here and make sure you don't miss anything. So after assuming that Dave will strike, Porky is faced with a choice. Should I strike or should I not strike? Let's consider both the scenarios. If Porky does strike, then we will end up in case three, where both of them are striking, both of them bang their heads, and both of them fall unconscious. So it's a minus one to both, right? In the other case, if Porky decides to not strike, then it is case two, right? Where Davy gets the grain and Porky remains hungry. So if Porky is deciding whether to strike or not, he has these two choices, either bang his head and pass out or remain hungry, right? So it's better to remain hungry than to fall unconscious, right? And hurt yourself. So right now, Porky will decide to not strike. This is fairly clear, right? I'll give a quick recap. best case scenario for Dave is when he strikes. So Porky will think that Dave will strike. Now Porky has two choices, either strike or don't strike. If he strikes, then he will hurt himself. If he doesn't strike, then he'll remain hungry. Which is better for Porky? Of course, remaining hungry is better than getting hurt, right? So Porky will decide to not strike. And here's the catch. The same thing happens with Dave. So just like we analyzed what Porky might be thinking, we could also have analyzed what Dave might be thinking. So by similar reasoning, we can also say that just like Porky concluded that he should not strike, Dave will also conclude that he should not strike. So is this clear? Just like we analyzed Porky's thought process, we could even have analyzed Dave's thought process. And since both of them are perfectly equal, as we had in our assumptions, Dave will also not strike, right? So this right now, we are at a situation where both of them are thinking that since the opponent is more likely to strike, I should not strike. So right now, both of them are thinking that we should not strike. Let's move on. So this is what's happening. It's currently case four when none of them strikes. But it's not over here. Recall our assumption that each of the pigeons is a perfect logician, the perfect rationality assumption. So each pigeon also knows what the other is thinking, right? Because he can think like the other pigeon too. I'll go slow over here. Each pigeon knows what the other is thinking. So Porky knows that Dave is thinking to not strike, and Dave knows that Porky is thinking to not strike. So since Porky knows that Dave will not strike, he says, I should strike, right? If Dave is not striking, then I should strike because I can then get the grain, and that's the best scenario for me. So Porky decides, okay, let me strike. But again, Dave also has similar reasonings, and so Dave will decide, okay, let me strike as well. And what happens is, then both of them think they should strike. And then both of them think, no, the other one would be striking, so I should not strike. And then both of them think, since the other one is not striking, I should strike. And this goes on forever, and neither of the pigeon can ever make up their mind. So in the end, what happens is both of them just stay there. They don't strike because they're fearing that they will bang their heads. So this loop goes on until infinity. And in the end, none of the pigeon gets the grain. So that is completely counterintuitive, something that doesn't really happen in real life, and we'll come to why that doesn't happen. But before that, I'll go over this flowchart once again. So what we did was, we considered what Porky might be thinking, right? So since the best scenario for Dave is when he strikes, Porky will think that Dave will strike. Fair assumption. Then Porky has a choice. Either he can strike or he can remain hungry. And of course, remaining hungry is better than getting hurt, right? So Porky decides that he will not strike. Dave, on the other hand, also has similar thought processes. So even what we did with Porky right now can just be reversed, and we can do the same thing with Dave. So Dave will think that Porky will strike, and so Dave will not strike. So currently, neither of them will strike. Right? So we are at the bottom over here where we've written none strikes, case four, right? So both of them are thinking that we should not strike or we will bang our heads and pass out. But each of the pigeon knows that the other would not strike. And so they think, okay, let me strike. If the other one is not striking, then I should strike and get the grain, right? So before striking, he thinks one last time that should I strike? And then he recalls that since I am thinking of striking, the other one will also be thinking of striking. And if we both strike, then we will both get hurt. And that's not what I want. I don't want to get hurt. It's okay if I remain hungry, but I don't want to get hurt. So both of them don't strike. And then both of them know that they're not striking. So they say, okay, the other one is not striking. I should strike. And then both of them think, oh, the other one is striking. If I strike, then I'll pass out. So I'll not strike. So this is just like the very first example we saw. I can clearly not choose the mine in front of you because so and so and so. And I clearly cannot choose the mine in front of me because so and so and so. So this is what happens in game theory. You analyze what an opponent is thinking. You imagine what they might be thinking. So it's an iterative process, right? You think of a move. then you think that your opponent might be thinking of me playing that move. Then I think, okay, I am thinking of my opponent thinking about me. And then I am thinking of my opponent thinking about me thinking about my opponent thinking about me, right? So this chain goes on, and quite often in game theory, the end result is not very specified or favorable, whatever you want to call it, right? So I'll stop sharing right now, and I'll open the floor for questions, right? So I'm sure there will be questions over here. Right, so I see. So this seems counterintuitive that no grain and pass out have different meanings. Okay, yeah, so that's the difference between case 3 and case 4. So in case 3, both of them strike and neither of them gets the grain. Both of them pass out, they fall unconscious. So nobody gets the grain. In case 4, they don't strike, but they still don't get the grain, right? Because to get the grain, you need to strike. So in this scenario, I can argue that for Porky, if it doesn't get the grain, it is equally as bad as banging heads and passing out. No, of course, it's better to remain hungry than to hurt yourself, right? So it's a definitive choice. You cannot choose to get the grain if you know that you're going to pass out, right? Cool. So any other questions? Feel free to raise your hand and ask me questions. Okay, so we have a question over here. Also, if we add the total marks of all cases, it adds up to 0. Is it valid? Okay. Yeah, so in case, yeah, so overall, that is also a reasoning that could be given for neither of them getting the grain. So in net-net, the scenario is equally favorable. I mean, there's no gain or loss if we consider all the situations, right? So that could be another reasoning. That's correct, right? Ah, this is a nice question. So one who is perfectly rational will have better chances of one who is not perfectly rational will have better chances of getting the grain. Ah, this is where the role of economics comes in, right? So this is a very interesting field that's on right now. It's called econometrics, which is kind of based on this. So what happens is a lot of models in economics are modeled based on the perfect rationality assumption. But that does not hold. So I'll come back to that in the end of the talk, that why such things do not happen in real life. Right? So even if you hurt yourself, you cannot get the grain. Yes, so that is why case 3 is the least favorable for both the pigeons, because they both fall unconscious and nobody gets the grain. Right? So case 3 is the least favorable for both the pigeons. Right, so any more questions? I mean, I'm free to answer questions right now, because this is the heart of what I'm discussing, right? So this is, if you have any questions, any doubts, just post them, ask them. There's no wrong thing. You can even raise your hand. You'll be unmuted. You can ask directly also. That also works perfectly fine. What if there are N pigeons? So this will get super complicated, right? So just in two pigeons, you saw how much thinking, how much counter analysis we had to do. So for multiple such pigeons, it will be very difficult to analyze by human beings. Although we can pass it on to a computer, computers can be programmed to do such stuff. And of course, this happens, right? So let's take the example of stock market. This is a very general example. I won't be going into the details, but if the stock market was a two pigeon case, then we would have only two buyers and sellers. So one of them buys, the other doesn't. So that, of course, is not the case, right? Stock market is huge. So many people investing in the stock market. So that's kind of an N pigeon problem, right? So you know how complex the stock market is. Can this be solved by mathematical logic? By mathematical logic, yes, this can be rigorized, but I think it's way more fun and interesting when we actually think it through ourselves. You enjoy it more when you do it yourself, right? So if you're doing math, then game theory kind of gets dry. But if you're actually into it, if you understand what the situation is, then game theory has so many things that are still to explore, right? So there's so many arenas that you can do. How can this thinking strategy be applied in real life situations? In this case, Porky and Dave have the same intellect level, and that definitely is not the case in real life. Yes, so I'll get back to why this does not happen in real life. You're hinting at it, but I'll come back to it why this thing does not happen in real life at the end, right? If you have n pigeons in n plus one grains, and assuming perfectly greedy pigeons, what will happen? I honestly don't know. Right now we had two pigeons and one grain, and so we could only have one winner. But if you have multiple pigeons and more grains than the number of pigeons, then this is really weird, because a pigeon can get two grains, a pigeon can get no grain. It's a very difficult problem to solve by hand, and especially in the generalized way, n plus one way. So I honestly do not have a thorough answer to that, but I can say that it's very complicated. Can we impart this into business? Honestly, this is being used in business. So a very common example for game theory being applied in real life is, do it like this. Consider two pharmaceutical companies, right? So both the pharmaceutical companies plan to release a new medicine for a certain disease, right? But neither of those companies is perfectly sure that drug will work. So that's where game theory comes in. Both of them know that the other one has developed a drug, right? The medicine, now they have a choice whether to release it before the other company or after the other company. That will be based on the chances that if the other company releases their medicine before the company in question does, then it may pass, it may fail. If it's failing, then this company will have a better chance. If it's passing, then this company will, of course, lose their business. So that is what you do. You analyze what the other's prospects are. You analyze how likely something is. And in the end, you decide whether to do it right now or later, right? So this is where game theory is actually applied in life. What will happen if one of these pigeons strikes? What will the other pigeon do? So that's what we did, right? So if both of the pigeons are perfectly rational, and they know that what the other one is thinking, and they're both perfect logicians, they are super smart, then in the end, none of them will strike. But say one of them does decide to strike, then of course it will depend. Because if one of them does strike, then that will only be the case where our assumptions do not hold true. So if one of the pigeons is not a perfect logician, then there is a chance that one of the pigeons will strike. So that's pretty much what happens if one of the pigeons strikes. And it depends on how irrational the pigeons are. So that's kind of complicated.
I can't understand the meaning of rational.
Okay. So rational is something that you... I use Hindi over here to make it clear. Soch samajh ke karna is kind of rational, right? So you take in all the possibilities. So if I say have this pen over here, if I had to make a rational decision whether to use this pen or not, then I would take all the factors into account. How old this pen is, this company, do the pens of this company usually leak? If I write, the paper quality, will that support me writing with this pen? So there are a lot of different things that are used here, right?
Okay.
So that is perfect rationality, where you take into account all the factors that can influence your outcome, and you make a decision based on that. That is rationality. Good question. What if in the Monty Hall problem is with two people, game theory can be applied? Wonderful. Monty Hall problem is a very common application of game theory. That also has a hint of probability to it. So what we did over here is kind of a basic level analysis. Monty Hall problem is one level ahead of this, but I won't be going into that in this talk. That's maybe for some other time, because that's something that's really deep and even more non-intuitive than this thing, right? So we'll go into that sometime later. Is that all the questions? Feel free to ask. I saw someone raise their hand in the middle, but I couldn't say that. Was that the person who asked about the rationality thing? Okay, you have a raised hand.
Actually was to raise the hand.
Okay, cool. So that's that. Is that it?
I guess that's all the questions. We can continue.
Yeah, okay, cool, perfect. So there's not a lot of thing that I have remaining right now. It's just a summing up type. So I'll reshare my screen. So we did the analysis. We did the analysis over here and found out that if both the pigeons are perfect rationals, then neither of them gets the grain. So in the end, you lose the bet because you voted for scenario one. And the results of the poll were, which I conducted in the beginning, they were actually very good. Most of you voted that neither of them gets the grain. About 83% of you thought that neither of them will get the grain, and that's the right choice if both of them are perfect rational pigeons. Now I'll come to the part why this does not hold in real life. So in real life, if you place a grain between two pigeons, then one of them will strike and get the grain while the other one will just walk away. So why does this happen in real life? Why doesn't our analysis hold true? Okay, so before I go on to that, I want you people to answer this. Let me know. You can feel free to raise your hand and ask whatever thing you, I mean, provide your opinion. Why doesn't this happen in real life? I want to know from you people. Yeah, go on, Tanmay.
Real life, in real life, both the pigeons are not perfectly rational and they are not, means in real life, it is a question of strength in case of pigeons.
Okay.
They are not equal.
Right, okay. That's right. Okay, so that's one opinion. Next. Samyak, can you speak? I can't hear you. Are you speaking? I still can't hear you, Samyak. Try raising your hand again. Anyone can answer. Feel free. I mean, I'm going to take three or four, then I'm going to discuss the actual reasons.
We also have an opinion in the chat. Mitesh Jain has said that in real life, both the competitors are not equally strong. They know their strengths and weakness over the other.
Okay, cool, perfect.
Yes, we can consider one case where if one of the pigeon takes the risk and strike, the other pigeon will consider, now if he is striking, I also try to strike, I will get hurt. He has striked first, he has more chance of reaching there before. So it is best that I don't try to strike and pass out. So we can consider that. And here, it is only a base if the second pigeon is willing to take the risk. Ke chalega, jo hoga dekha jayega. We will strike if, so that is why, that if, and if I take the risk, that is why it does not happen in real life.
Okay, perfect. Nice. You're very close to what it is. I mean, you're almost there. Okay, so in the chat, someone is saying neither are they perfect logicians at all times. Okay. Interesting. Cool. So I think we'll get to the actual reasons. And all of you were nearly there. So all of you had nearly the perfect idea, right? So let's go back to the slide where we saw the assumptions that we had, right? We made three assumptions. So that's where the key lies, why this does not happen in real life. Let's get back there. Right. So what we will find is that there is a flaw in each of these assumptions. The first one is that, I mean, let's read the assumptions once again and let's then discuss the flaw. So the first assumption states, each pigeon is smart enough to know that if he bangs his head with the other one, he will pass out. This is often not the case because pigeons don't know about banging their heads. I mean, it's not really a very common occurrence, right? So even though they might have natural instincts, but this does not really play a major role. The second is the perfect rationality assumption. This is where the most grievous flaw is. No being is perfectly rational, not even human beings, not even the best of economists. Nobody is perfectly rational, right? So like someone said, jo hoga dekha jayega. That is often the attitude, and that is a completely irrational attitude. A rational being never says jo hoga dekha jayega. It's always soch samajh ke kaam karna, as I said. So agar soch samajh ke kaam kar rahe hain to jo hoga dekha jayega wala situation kabhi nahi aata hai. So the perfect rationality assumption does not hold in any real life case, and this is an ideal case that you were discussing. So that this is the major flaw. And third, each pigeon is equally hungry. Again, this is also flawed, since not all pigeons are equal. Some of them are stronger, because they're elder to other pigeons. Baby pigeons cannot strike. The one who is more hungry will go on to take a higher risk. And you know, so all sorts of case come in here. What we were assuming here, that both of the pigeons are perfectly equal. They had perfect logical senses. They were perfectly equally hungry. And, you know, we made a lot of assumptions over here. So these three assumptions are a mask to so many assumptions that we made here. But still, even though our analysis does not apply immediately to real life, we can tweak it a bit to resemble real life situations more closely. And this is what economics, econometrics, statistics, data analysis, all this deals with. That you have a lot of data, and you analyze that data to see how far you are from the ideal case. And depending on how deviated you are, you make changes to your ideal case to fit the real life situation as closely as possible so that you can predict the future, right? So this ideal case of game theory is like a starting point, a seed for so many wide applications. It's nearly everywhere. So if a company is releasing a product, if someone's investing in the stock market, if the Hubble telescope is searching for stars, if people in the marine department are searching for whales, nearly everywhere the computer, everything that is computerized is almost always stemming from the fundamentals of game theory. Of course, there are really important contributions from other fields as well, but game theory always holds one of the places that is at the very heart of what computer analysis today is, right? So computers essentially work on logic, right? We've all studied in our grade 6, 7, 8 or something, properties of a computer. I think we remember computers are dumb, we say, because they cannot perform any tasks on their own. We need to program them. So how do we program them? We use game theory basics. So we tell them what to do. We tell them how to think, not think in the true sense, but we tell them how to analyze what they have to predict the future. And that is what is making tremendous advances right now in the form of artificial intelligence, machine learning. So what is machine learning? Machine learning is essentially just a game theory. You make a model, you compare it with real life, you collect data, and then you tweak your model to fit real life. And that is what machine learning essentially is, completely based on game theory, right? So this is where our analysis breaks down and does not apply to real life. These assumptions are the culprits over here, right? So let's get back to this once more. I wanted to show you one more thing. So this is the point which I wanted to show you. This loop goes on till infinity, right? So just one interesting fact over here is, if you do not disturb the pigeons and their perfect logicians and all the ideal assumptions hold, then they just keep sitting there staring at one another. And yet so much, this whole flowchart is going through their mind super quickly, right? So can you imagine how intricate this is? Like, even though on the outside you cannot see anything happening, the details of the system, what's going on in the pigeons' minds, this is so intricate that it's beautiful in a sense, how even though there's so much of analysis going on, there's no outcome, right? So this is also one of the major things that has influenced game theory, the development of game theory and machine learning in recent times. Right. So that's the official end of my talk. You can contact me at jain.ashpath@gmail.com for any feedback or questions you may have. I hope you enjoyed this talk, and I am completely open for questions right now. So any questions you may have relating to any part of the talk, feel free. Let's make this interactive, as Devin said in the chat. Ask questions. You can even give your opinions. It need not be a question. If you have something to say, feel free. We have a question here. So if there is a perfectly rational being, will it always lose? No. Absolutely not. Rational beings, perfectly rational beings cannot exist. Say they do exist, right? So this is interesting. Say perfectly rational beings do exist. They are rational, but their opponent is not rational. So the rational being knows what the opponent is thinking, but the opponent does not know what the rational being is thinking, right? So in that sense, a rational being has an advantage over a non-rational being. On the other hand, a non-rational being can go for jo hoga so dekha jayega wala case, as someone perfectly pointed out. Those are like the perfect words for irrationality. So if the irrational person goes for jo hoga so dekha jayega, then he will of course have an advantage over the rational being, who will analyze the situation properly and will not take any risks. However, some things are achieved only by taking risks. Without that, you cannot proceed forward in real life. So in that case, a rational being has an advantage over an irrational being. So we cannot say which one will win. It depends on the situation, how irrational the irrational guy is, lot of things over there. So is it preferable to be logical or taking risks? So that again is something that you need to logically think, depends on the situation. If it's a situation where you know that being logical is better. So let's say, for example, the IPL is currently going on, right? So say you are the batsman, last over, and you need, say, 10 runs to win. Then, of course, you need to take risks. You cannot play logically and say that, only if the ball is pitched wide outside off, I will go for a sweep, reverse sweep or something like that, and only then will I hit a six. It's a necessity right now. You need to hit a six, even if that means losing your wicket. So in those cases, a risk is important. However, if it's something like, say, you're the CEO of a company and you're releasing a very good product. However, okay, let's we've taken this example. Let's say you're a director and you're releasing a movie, and a very similar movie has already been released or is about to be released in the market soon, within the near future. So in that case, you need to think, is it good if I release my movie right now? Should I wait another year or should I do something else? So in that case, risk is not something that is very great. You need to think logically, what will happen? How many people will like the movie? What's my genre to be, my target audience? So there's a lot of things you need to consider there. So it really depends on the case whether you want to do it right now, or I mean, if you want to take the risk or do it logically. Any more questions? Encouraging questions. You can even give opinions, right? So anything you have to say, just feel free, raise your hand and speak. Yes, someone has raised their hands.
Can a perfectly rational being, two perfectly rational beings in a game, choose situations in which they both lose something and none of them profits?
No, then that, if there is a situation where, if there is a better situation for them, then they will not do that, right? So even in the, let's just take the pigeon example again. So if, since there was a better situation than passing, than banging their heads and falling unconscious, there was an outcome that was better than that. In fact, that was the worst possible outcome. So that will never happen when you have two perfectly rational beings competing in a game, right? So unless that is the only option, that won't happen. So, like, what's the significance of learning game theory if it's not applicable in real life? As I said, ideal game theory is not applicable in real life, but with suitable modifications, it applies everywhere, like in almost every field. It is nearly as widespread as computers right now. So it's applicable everywhere, just that the perfectly ideal case is not sometimes the best case to model real life situations. You need to make certain changes to it.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes. Now, I have a question. Let us consider there is a crime and the police has found that there are two suspects. We don't know if...
I suddenly lost your voice. I can't hear anymore. Is it a problem on my end, Nikhil Deven? One can one of you
come? No, I think it's Samyak's net issue. Okay, Samyak.
All right. So we don't know if someone is guilty or innocent. If one of them confesses that we have done this, then for confession he will be left and the other person will be jailed for a long time. And if both of them
one second. So the criminal confesses to his crime, then why will the other person be jailed?
No. There are two suspects.
Mm-hmm.
If the one of them says that we, both of us, have done this crime, say a murder, assume.
Okay.
So, on basis of good behavior and cooperation, the first guy is allowed to go, the one who confessed, and the one who did not confess and remained silent is jailed for a very long time.
Okay.
If both of them confess that we have done, then both of them are jailed for a comparatively short time. And if both of them remain silent, because they have been suspects and because they have, say, some past records or something, both of them will be jailed for even shorter time. So which is preferable?
This is exactly the same example as the pigeon case. I'm by the way assuming that both of the criminals are perfect logicians, right? So this is the same example as what we did, exactly the same. So confessing is similar to striking. Not confessing is similar to waiting. So if you strike and your partner is actually your opponent, right? So if both of you confess, then both of you go to jail. That is, you bang your heads and pass out. If both of you don't confess, then you still don't get to be free. You still go to jail. That is, nobody gets the grain. If one of them strikes, that means one of them confesses, then he wins and the other loses. And so those were the four cases we saw, right? So this is the exact same problem that we saw here.
But
this is like the prisoner's paradox.
But here, anyhow, someone has to go to jail.
Anyhow, someone had to lose, right? So in the pigeon case, losing meant either not getting the grain or passing out. Even here, losing means either going to jail for a short time or a long time.
But there is a constraint, as Tanmay said. Because now if we remain silent, we can either be jailed for a very less time or we can be jailed for a very long time. Even for remaining silent and for confessing also, you can be jailed and you can be left free.
So that's what happened in the pigeon case, right? If you strike, then either you get the grain, that is you jail for a short time, or you're left, that is you win. Or if even for striking, you get a very harsh penalty of being unconscious. And even if you don't strike, then you either don't get the grain or neither of you get the grain, right? So it's similar, yes. It's similar to a very high extent. There are small things that might differ, but the overall analysis will be pretty much on these lines.
So what is preferable? I want your opinion.
I can't say what is preferable, but as far as I think, if both of them are perfect logicians, neither of them will confess. Because what I'm doing is extending the results of our current analysis to your question. So current analysis, we saw that neither of them strikes. So that's probably what will happen, but I can't be sure. Okay, so this is like the prisoner's paradox, isn't it? Kind of. It is. How both the prisoners... but in this case, time is a constraint, isn't it? Not really, because they can always choose to remain silent in the end, right? Just like both of the prisoners chose not to strike in the end. How will both the prisoners go to jail when both of them confess if we have a situation where one confesses and can escape? I don't know. That question is probably better addressed to Samyak for cooperation. Okay, yeah, Samyak answered that. Cool. Go on. I mean, perfect. I like this discussion that's going on. Please continue. I mean, it's actually good to have these discussions. Is there nothing else? Nobody would like to share anything? Okay, yeah, we have a question. Is Dog and Bone game similar to Crow example? It is similar in the sense that it involves game theory. You need to think what your opponent is doing, but not really, because in this case, both of the players had two choices. In that, in a sense, we can consider it. So this is like the very basic example where you have two players and both of them lose or one of them wins. You do not have the win-win case, right? So the moment you introduce the win-win case, the analysis gets a little complex. So as long as you're considering these types of games, it's perfect. Okay, so this question about the prisoners thing, confessing crime, we can get away from that, right? Because that's something that's not very clear to us right now because we still don't have the perfect details about it. Right, so is that it? I mean, I'm available for more questions if you like. And if you have a question after this, you can feel free to drop me a mail. So it's fine if you have any more questions. I mean, I'm ready. Okay, we have a question. Is it logical to apply game theory in chess? Okay, so chess is like an extreme form of game theory. In a sense, we do apply game theory in chess, right? So when you play chess, you think that if I play this move, my opponent can play this, and then I can play this. And then you don't go up to an infinite stage in chess because, okay, if you were a perfectly rational being, then you would analyze each and every possible sequence of games at the very first move. So that won't happen, right? So if you were perfectly logical, then you could analyze complete all the possible games that could be there, and that's a very, very, very huge number, right? So number of possible chess games is a really large number. You can look for it online. But if you are a perfectly rational being, then you would do that. However, even if you're irrational, you do that to a certain extent, right? So you think what the opponent is going to play, what will I play in response to that. So you don't just make moves on your own accord. You see what the opponent is doing, right? So in a sense, you do apply game theory to chess. Right, Nikhil. Cool, so I think that's that. Over to you, Nikhil, Devin.
Okay, so that's I guess the end of the questions, and it was really nice having you here, Ashwath. The session was great. I mean, I'm really sure that everyone enjoyed it a lot, and I would just go through the formalities. So I would like to thank all the audience for attending and participating interactively, most importantly. We're also grateful to Ashwath for such an informative session, sparing out his valuable time for us. And we are really looking forward to have you again. And so thanks a lot, everyone, for joining.